go to get a pencil. Let me get a pen.
Okay, right.
Bye, Zachary. Zachary with a BB.
Yeah.
Okay.
She was on the football team. I think they were just arrested back in February. He showed up at the house with the cops.
Yeah.
Oh my God.
Yeah.
Come on.
Yeah. Come yeah.
On. He's 74 years old.
I know.
That's a come on.
Yeah.
Amen. Thank you, Mike. Beloved sisters, brothers, members, guests, and friends, saints of God throughout time and space, welcome once more to Richville United Church of Christ, and this the Lord's Day. Today, amidst our regular celebrations, we lift up All Saints Sunday, and we give God thanks for our forebearers in the faith who have gone before us. Today also kicks off our stewardship season for the year. We won't be discussing it a ton this Sunday because we've got so much else going on, but this is the time of year when we look forward toward using God's resources appropriately, contributing our best for the year ahead. And finally, of course, today is celebration of the Lord's Supper, Communion Sunday. So if you have not as yet, please head out to the narthex and grab your communion packets. And for those of you who are joining us at home, if you did not pick them up throughout the week, you of course can use whatever materials you have in your own home, and we'll be asking God's blessing upon those elements later in the service. I would ask everybody to draw their attention to the weekly messenger, our insert with our calendar and updates. And for those of you who are joining us online, you can go to richvilleucc.com, go to the bulletins and newsletter tab, and there you can download both the worship folder and the weekly messenger update. As I draw your attention to some of this week's announcements, if you saw on the table with the communion kits and our daily bread upper room, you'll also notice, and it came out in the newsletter that got mailed out earlier in the week, we do have this year's pledge cards for your time, talents, and treasures. And our theme this year for stewardship season is what's next, what's next. Speaking of stewardship and what's next, we are still in the midst of planning some of our seasonal mission projects through our outreach committee, but we just got word that Perry Helping Perry's community Christmas assistance, the donations need to be in by December 15th, and they're asking for donations of toys for $20 to $25, or gift cards up to $25 for the teens. We'll be sharing that information both online and in print in the weeks ahead. I do want to share in honor of All Saints Sunday that some of the saints of this congregation have been blessed with the gift of new life in the last week. So Bill and Gail McGrady, you'll notice that we have a rose on the communion table behind the Bible today. That is in honor of their new granddaughter, Kinsley Ann, born to Tim and Lori. A healthy baby, born on October 24th. So we give God praise for the life of all God's children, past, present, and future. Loved ones, if there are no other further announcements for the congregation, I do want to invite and encourage everybody to join us after service today. From noon to two, we are still planning on having our trunk or treat and best dressed pet event out in the parking lot and under the pavilion shelter. Of course, tomorrow night at 6:30 is consistory. With that, is there anything else that you all need to lift up for one another's benefit? Seeing none at the moment, I do remind you can always sign on to all of our social media accounts to get the most current information as it rolls out throughout the week. Loved ones, we are children of God, made in the Lord's image, redeemed by the blood of the Lamb, empowered by the Holy Spirit. So let us give our thanks and praise to our God, our King, our Creator, Redeemer, and Sustainer, with number 77. And it is also our litany of remembrance for the saints who have gone home to the Lord out of this congregation over the last year. Let us bless the Lord at all times. May God's praise be continually in our mouths.
Our souls boast in the Holy One, and all ones join us in gladness.
Forgive us then, we pray, when we don't magnify you, when we fail to exalt your name together.
Strengthen us to seek you once more, for when you do, you answer and deliver us from all of our fears.
When we look to you, you make us radiant and our faces are unashamed.
Indeed, every poor soul who has cried out to you is saved from their troubles. Your angels have encamped around those who stand among you, and you have delivered them.
With all of these things in mind, we lift up before you now a celebration of remembrance for the great cloud of witnesses who have gone on before us. In the moments ahead, loved ones, we will silently meditate and then share the names of our own members who have returned to God's embrace over the last year. For those of you who are joining us online, please feel free to type in your loved ones' names in the comments section. And after we've concluded reading the names of our own parishioners, as the Spirit leads you, those of you in attendance, feel free to speak aloud your loved ones' names. Giver of life and conqueror of death, we give thanks and commend to you our sisters and brothers who have returned to your eternal embrace over the last year here at Richfield United Church of Christ. We lift up before you Don Reeder, Timmy Provost, Sandra Harvey, Eldon Cecil, Don Peretta, Sam Kalinchuk, and Janice Stepp. Written, spoken, or silently thought, Holy One, we entrust to you the great cloud of witnesses, the saints and the lights. May they and we eternally taste and see that you are good. Grant them and us happiness and refuge in you. We long to be your holy ones like them, to stand in reverent fear and be freed from want. Though even young lions will suffer in hunger, those who seek you will ultimately lack no good thing. Amen.
New International Version. Now when Jesus saw the crowds, he went up on the mountainside and sat down. His disciples came to him, and he began to teach them. He said, "Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they will inherit the earth. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they will be filled. Blessed are the merciful, for they will be shown mercy. Blessed are the poor in heart, for they will see God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they will be called the children of God. Blessed are those who are persecuted because of righteousness, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are you when people insult you, persecute you, and falsely say all kinds of evil things against you because of me. Rejoice and be glad, because great is your reward in heaven, for in the same way they persecuted the prophets who were before you."
Amen. Thank you, Bonnie. That's God's good news to and for the people of God, according to Matthew's gospel. And we pray, as always, that the Lord would bless our reading, our hearing, our understanding, and of course, most importantly, our application of this and all of Holy Scripture. As we pray that prayer, we first want to spend a few moments sharing God's love and truth with our youngest friends. And as we have instituted safety protocols during the pandemic, we do ask the kids to remain in their family units and pews until it's time to be dismissed for Sunday school downstairs with Miss Jennifer. So with that, this is the day the Lord has made. We will rejoice and be glad in it. I am a child of the Most High God, wonderfully and fearfully made. Amen. Fantastic. Every person is made in the image of God and is a gift, and every day is a gift from God, whether it feels like it all the time or not. So for instance, today, some people are super happy that autumn is here and there was cool, crisp rain and the leaves are changing color and falling to the ground, and other folks are a little bummed out for the same reasons. But even on those rough days, we can give thanks and see God working in them. Well, today, I want to talk to you guys about being happy or blessed in every circumstance. Did you hear that word over and over again in the passage that Miss Bonnie read for us today? Blessed are, blessed are. And one way of understanding that word is happy. So I wanna do a familiar song with you guys, okay? If you're happy and you know it, clap your hands. If you're happy and you know it, clap your hands. If you're happy and you know it, then your face will surely show it. If you're happy and you know it, clap your hands. How would that song go if you were a bunch of birds? Good, good, okay. If you're happy and you know it, maybe flap your wings. What if you were a doggy? If you're happy and you know it, wiggle your tail. Well, I heard a story about a little puppy that noticed whenever he was happy, his tail started to wag. So he thought that he had found the secret to happiness. One day he shared the secret of happiness with an older dog. He said, I learned that the best thing for a dog is happiness. And that happiness is in my tail. Every time I chase it, it makes me happy and I see it wiggling and I want to get closer to that happiness. And the older dog replied, I too believe that happiness is in my tail. And I noticed that it's a marvelous thing for a dog to pursue happiness. But I've also noticed that when I chase it, I can't quite catch it. But for me, every time I chase my tail, which is happy, it brings me happiness. When we hear these words of Jesus that Miss Bonnie lifted up for us today, and we think about it in terms of animals, right? Like that dog chasing after his tail because it makes him happy. I was thinking about that, and I was also thinking about our best dressed pet event after church today. So I have here my little friend. This is one of my kids' pets. This is Lanty, a green lantern. Green Lantern. And you know what's cool about Green Lantern? What kind of a pet is he? He's a turtle. And you know what? What's cool about turtles and what it has to do with today's Bible reading that Miss Bonnie shared? Does a turtle get protection?
Yes.
Yeah? If it's raining outside, is the turtle protected?
Yes.
Yeah. If an animal comes along, a big mean animal comes along and wants to try to hurt the turtle, can it have some protection?
Yes.
Yeah, the bigger animal will have to have some pretty powerful jaws to break through this shell. You see Lanty, he's crawling around, but when I came near him like that, he crawled back inside of his shell. So Lanty, the really cool thing about Lanty and turtles like him is kind of one of the cool things about being Christians who listen to the teachings of Jesus, the happy are, the blessed are statements. Christians, no matter what kind of a day we're going through, no matter how things look outside and around us, we get to carry God's kingdom everywhere we go. We're always at home, no matter where we are. We're always protected for eternity under the teachings of Jesus, the happy are, the blessed are's, right? You can have a terrible, no good, very bad, rotten day, but still be under God's care and protection, and you curl up inside the teachings and the love and the forgiveness of Jesus. And even on those days when you feel like maybe you're being bullied, or even on those days where you're not sure how you're gonna make it through that homework that's so hard, you can crawl up inside of God's embrace and say, I'm happy, I'm blessed, because I follow Jesus. And I can walk through this world even when I don't know exactly where I'm going, because God is always with me, and the promises of the Lord protect and direct me. So before we let our little animal saint run astray, let's go ahead and pray together. And then I'm going to dismiss you guys to Sunday school downstairs with Miss Jennifer. Let's talk to the Lord. Holy God, we thank you on this day that we are indeed blessed and we can clap our hands in happiness for all the goodness that you shower upon us and protect us with, even in a world that doesn't always feel good, even on the days when we don't feel good. Help us continue to learn and grow about the way of Jesus. Help us look forward to what's next when we follow his path. And may we curl up inside the home of your embrace that is always with us. Now, all of this and more, we pray so that our kids would continue to learn and grow under the leadership of Miss Jennifer. And we ask it in the name of your son, your holy child, our precious brother, savior, and Lord, Jesus the Christ. And may all God's kids say, amen. All right. You guys can meet Miss Jennifer in the back of the sanctuary and head on to Sunday school. As the kiddos make their way toward their time of continuing spiritual formation, I'd ask that you all would join me in another moment of prayer as we seek the Lord's blessing upon our conversation and our understanding of the scriptures. Good and gracious God, who has gifted us with the family of faith around the globe and throughout the ages, we ask on this day when we gather around your table in unity, as we lift up with thanksgiving the memory of our sisters and brothers who've returned to their eternal home, we'd ask that you would help us see and understand, put into practice and reveal to others your kingdom of heaven. And Lord, as we wrestle with the scriptures and their implication for our lives and life together, I'd ask that the words of my mouth and the thoughts and meditations of each of our hearts and minds might be acceptable in your sight. For this we pray through our rock and redeemer, the living word, the resurrected and resurrecting one, Jesus the Christ. And may all God's people say, amen. Amen. Before I begin today's message time, I'm going to pull a Governor DeWine on the beginning of one of his twice weekly press conferences recently. You may notice the tie that I'm wearing. I'm wearing this in honor of All Saints Sunday. This is the Stuart Royal Hunting Plaid. So this is in honor of my family, the Stuart clan, and both our ethnic and our Christian roots going back generation upon generation. And that makes me think about the joy and expectation of parenting. Praise God, we have young ones, absolutely new young ones in the sanctuary with us today, as well as ones who are on their path of life and growth. For those of us who are or have been parents, can you think about how wonderful it was when you held your first child in particular, all of them, but your first child in your arms? The dreams you dreamed for them, the hopes and aspirations that you projected onto them, the requests that you lifted up before God on their behalf. There was so much power and promise in those first moments of life for each of our kids. Similar to this, there was the instance of a young mom who wanted her son, a newborn, to become an athlete just like his father. And so at about 1 week old, the mom got out a football and tossed it at the baby. The baby couldn't catch it. Similarly, I wanted to raise my kids with an awareness of the Stuart family heritage, our Scots-Irish roots. So once they switched to solid food, I started feeding them haggis. They didn't like it very much. What's my point with these two silly anecdotes? We are a people of becoming. We are not a people who have arrived. And as we look at today's texts, we have to understand that there is a continual process of growth and revelation for Christian discipleship. In recent weeks and during our fall sermon series about the way of Jesus. We were looking at the law and the Ten Commandments throughout Exodus quite a bit. And today, in the Matthew passage that Bonnie read for us, we get Jesus' version of the law for his followers, the commandments for those who would walk in his way under his yoke and mantle. The Beatitudes that come to us out of the Sermon on the Mount in Matthew or the Sermon on the Plain in Luke are the mission statement sermon of Jesus. If you want to understand who Jesus was, what he was about, and who he wants us to become, you have to pay attention to this central set of teachings. But much as we needed to make note as Christians under the New Covenant to be cautious about legalistic interpretations of the Ten Commandments, we have to be cautious about legalistic interpretations of the Beatitudes as well. We have to take them seriously, but we also need to be cautious about legalistic interpretations. Because if we aren't cautious in that regard, if we expect a new being to catch the football or eat solid food too soon, we fall into the trap of thinking we have arrived at who God would have us become. If we were to take the Beatitudes and twist them in Satan's grasp, they might sound something like this. Blessed are those who are too tired, too busy, too distracted to spend an hour once a week with their fellow Christians in church. They're my best workers. Blessed are those who wait to be asked and expect to be thanked. I can use them in my business. Blessed are those who are too touchy. Soon they will stop going to church. Verily, they shall be my missionaries. Blessed are those who sow gossip and trouble. They're my beloved children. Blessed are those who have no time to pray, for they become my prey. Blessed are those who gossip, for they are my secret agents. Blessed are you when you read this and think that everything in it has to do with other people and nothing to do with you. I've got room for you in my inn. We must remember that the good news is indeed good news. It is a law and it's a command that we need to live and walk under. Jesus calls us to even a higher standard than the Torah, but he does so with grace. For instance, there was a grandmother. She was celebrating her golden wedding anniversary, and she once told the secret of her long and happy marriage to her grandchildren. On my wedding day, I decided to make a list of 10 of my husband's faults, which, for the sake of our marriage, I would overlook. A guest asked the woman what some of the faults she had chosen to overlook were. And the grandmother replied, "To tell you the truth, my dear, I never did get around to listing them. But whenever my husband did something that made me hoppin' mad, I would say to myself, lucky for him, that's one of the 10. Today, the words of the Beatitudes encourage us, invite us to consider anew our dependence on God, to acknowledge the Lord as the supreme authority in our lives, and to find the source of our identity and happiness in becoming like him. There's an expression, shoot for the stars and land upon the moon. And that is the rule and guide of our faith as comes to us throughout the scriptures, but most especially in the Beatitudes. Indeed, the Sermon on the Mount opens with the Beatitudes. 8 statements beginning with the word blessed. It is the longest and fullest continued discourse of our Savior that we have recorded in the Gospels. But it's nothing new. It is a continuation of what God has always been revealing to us, that we are a people on a journey. The Beatitudes are about becoming. Think about even the setting of this scene. Jesus is in the region of Galilee, which is seen as the armpit of the Roman Empire. Surrounding him are not just his disciples, but the crowds, which would have been made up of a collection, a ramshackle, hodgepodge blending together
of the losers, the outcasts, the misfits, the dejected and rejected by society, as well as those who were part of the religious and political elite who heard something of power and promise in Jesus' teaching. This is not a word of hope for the people who have already arrived and have it all together. It is a word of encouragement and challenge for those who are longing to be more like the God of their creating, liberating, redeeming, sustaining, and ultimately, resurrection. We think about the importance of tense in today's gospel passage. Past, present, or future. Ours is both an imminent, a nearly or partially present, and a transcendent, an as yet realized or materialized kingdom, the one that Jesus preaches about. For when he says, blessed are, he's talking about the here and now. Just like the turtle shell, we are under the embrace of the kingdom of heaven in this fallen, broken, sinful world. But then Jesus goes on in the middle Beatitudes and says, blessed or happy will be those who continue to follow my teachings. Blessed are the poor in spirit. That has often been corrupted, twisted, misused to keep poor people in their place, to keep marginal people at the fringes of God's embrace. A better translation is happy are and will be those who are humble, who are meek, who are teachable, who are willing to learn and grow. It seems there was a gentleman by the name of Mr. Smith. He was brought to a Mercy hospital, a Catholic hospital, and he was taken in for emergency coronary surgery. The operation went well, and as the groggy man regained consciousness, he was reassured by one of the Sisters of Mercy who volunteered in that hospital. Mr. Smith, you're going to be just fine, said the nun, gently patting his hand. We do need to know, however, how you intend to pay for your stay here. Are you covered by insurance? No, I'm not, whispered the man, hoarse from the procedure. Then can you pay in cash? She asked it. I'm afraid not, sister. Well, do you have any close relatives? Asked the nun, a little more sternly this time. Just my sister in New Mexico, he volunteered. But she's a humble, older nun herself. Oh, Mr. Smith, I must correct you. You have this image of nuns as old spinsters, but we are married to God. Wonderful, said Mr. Smith. In that case, please send the bill to my brother-in-law. We have not arrived, and yet we are already covered by the insurance of the one who is what we want to become, but are not yet. We see this throughout today's scriptures. Psalm 34, a psalm of David, written during a period of time when he was faking his own insanity because he was being persecuted by Abimelech. In Psalm 34, David gave thanks for what God had done and was looking forward to what God would yet do while he was standing in the certain threat against his life of that moment. The cool, calm, collected Christ follower holds their head up high and retains their values and their ethics when everyone around them is losing their own mind. We are children of God. As today's First John reading out of chapter 3 will show us in our prayer of dedication, we have words of encouragement written to a community that was divided, was troubled by a schism. Not that that's ever happened in communities of faith or political, national bodies before, has it? We aren't given the details of the split. Historians have given us some insight as to the political and theological, the economic and ethnic tensions that existed in the early church, but we don't need to know the details to hear the words of encouragement in 1 John. We have this understanding that If we've experienced trauma because of splits in our families, in our cities, in our nations, in our denominations, we who are the children of God have not arrived. What it is that God wants to do in us has yet to be revealed. But we remain children of God who are learning and growing, figuring out how to catch that football or digest that solid food, if you can call haggis a food. By the way, did you know that most Scottish cuisine is based on a dare? Nevertheless, we are a people who are held together, and the unifying love and redeeming grace of Christ that is always calling us forward, calling forth from us greater purpose and promise. Not my will, but your will be done on earth as it will be perfectly done in heaven. An illustration of this comes from a young family that was driving home from church one Sunday. And a young man turned to his mother and said, "Mommy, there's something about the preacher's message this morning that I don't understand." The mother said, "Oh, what is it?" And the little boy replied, "Well, preacher said that God is bigger than we are. He said God is so big that he can hold the whole world in his hand. Is that true?" The mother replied, "Yes, Johnny, that's true, honey. But Mommy, he also said that God comes to live inside of us when we believe in Jesus as our Savior. Is that true too?" Again, the mother assured her young man that what the pastor had said was in fact true. With a puzzled look on his face, Johnny then asked, "If God is bigger than us and he lives in us, wouldn't he show through?" Ought that not be the point and the purpose and the promise of pursuing the path of the Prince of Peace? A continual revealing, unveiling, a becoming more and more Christian, Christ-like. Committing ourselves undyingly to his values, but also affording ourselves and others grace in the growth process. A promise and a purpose. These are not just laws and commands that we read in the Sermon on the Mount. They are be or do attitudes. They are operational. We are already blessed if we are humble. We are already in the kingdom of heaven if we're being persecuted because we're self-righteous jerks. No, because of his righteousness. But in the meantime, those two bookends of already being blessed, there is a calling forth for peacemaking, a calling forth for greater humility and seeking after God's, not humanity's, version of justice. Those who hunger and thirst for righteousness will be filled. That is probably the most simple prophecy in the New Testament. It's operational, as I just said, right? If you get hungry enough, you're going to get up off the couch, stop watching the game, go to the kitchen, open the fridge, get out the fixings for a sandwich, and then you'll eat it, and you will be filled if you make your hunger operational. So too, if we hunger and thirst for righteousness, if we hunger and thirst for more and more of Christ's kingdom in the kingdoms of this world, then eventually, whether it's here and now or on the far side of eternity when we rejoin the saints in the light, we will be filled. But just as the parent blesses their child when they are first born, before they become fully realized human beings, so too God blesses us the moment we are born again by confessing our faith and owning our sin under the grace of Jesus the Christ. We do not judge a toddler by the standards of a baccalaureate. We must pursue in order to receive. We ought to be careful that the kingdom of heaven is ours, but we need to manifest more of it in every arena of life, knowing that indeed, as we said before, God is the ultimate authority. The present conditions of the poor, the unfortunate, have assorted variations. Perhaps you feel yourself a political refugee. Maybe the theology of the assorted churches you've attended hasn't absolutely met your own. Maybe you've gone through generations of economic distress. Perhaps your gender or ethnicity causes others to look at you twice when they only look at most people once. Whatever your current struggles are, the kingdom is, and we are becoming kingdom people more and more whenever we walk in the way of Jesus. And today, as we think on this notion of becoming through the be or do attitudes, as children of God, redeemed through Christ, as we do so on All Saints' Day, getting ready to gather around the communion table, the Lord's Supper, I want to think, despite the pagan overtones of Halloween, I want to think about what we traditionally do on Halloween. So often, kids' costumes are aspirational, aren't they? When I was a kid, I dressed up on two separate occasions as Luke Skywalker and then as Yoda. I wanted to become a Jedi like Luke. I wanted to have that kind of divine power coursing through my life that allowed you to levitate boulders and spaceships like Yoda. Sadly, I have not yet learned how to wield a lightsaber, and though I am not green, I am now shorter than I was just a few years ago. Still, on this All Saints Day, the day after Halloween, when we're going to have this event out in the parking lot after service, I've been asked, what are you going as for Halloween for Trick or Trunk this year at Richville? And I said, I'm putting on my best good Christian pastor costume, because that's what I want to be. I haven't arrived. When I put on this stole and this cross for the sacraments, baptism, which we'll celebrate next week, the Lord's Supper that we're approaching right now, this is aspirational. I am a vicarious stand-in for the one that we all are trying to be more like. Not that we've arrived, but we get to come to the family table as children of God, who the Lord is going to reveal more through in the days ahead. We get to come to the table, not because we're worthy, but as they say, what you are, what you eat. So if we want to be more like our Lord and Savior, if we want to be nurtured and nourished to be and do like Christ, then we want to eat what he ate. We want to partake of his essence so that we can reveal it to the rest of the world. If we had continued reading in today's Matthew passage, we hear the famous words of Christ. You are the salt of the earth. But if the salt loses its saltiness, how can it be made salty again? It's no longer good for anything except to be thrown out and trampled upon by men. You are the light of the world. A city on a hill cannot be hidden. Neither do people light a lamp and put it under a bowl. Instead, they put it on its stand, and it gives light to everyone in the house. In the same way, let your light shine before all people, that they may see your good deeds and praise the Father in heaven. May we learn and grow. May we feast at the family table of being God's children. Amen. At this time, I do remind you that during the period of the pandemic, we've been using the individually sealed communion kits found at the back of the sanctuary. There are two flaps to them. The top one reveals the wafer. The bottom one reveals the grape juice. Dear friends, as we ready our hearts and minds to approach the banquet feast of the Lamb, let us center ourselves through song. Thank you. Dearest friends, beloved members of the body of Christ, both those present and socially distanced in the sanctuary, and those who are gathering in spirit under God's eternal embrace. We recall that on the last night of earthly festivities that Jesus would ever celebrate with his nearest and dearest, his closest friends and students, at the conclusion of the Passover meal, that ancient ritual meal of our Jewish forebears when they recalled God's act of liberation from the slavery of Egypt. At the end of that meal, Jesus brought forth fresh bread, and he poured a new cup. And he took the bread, and he blessed it, and gave thanks for it, and broke it, and said, "This is my body, broken for you." In the same way, he took the cup of the prophet Elijah, who was and was to come again, and he blessed it and gave thanks for it, and said, "This cup is the cup of the new covenant poured out in my blood for the forgiveness of the sins of the many. Anytime you eat this bread or drink this cup, do so in remembrance of me. But behold, we shall not share this meal together again until we do so anew in the Father's kingdom." But Jesus also said that whenever two or more gather in his name, he is present in their midst. So if we're eating the harvest of the field and drinking the fruit of the vine together in the name of Jesus, he is here with us, and we are, if only for a moment, already in the kingdom of heaven. Let us pray. Lord, Lord our God, you who are one, as we break and share the meal that you have provided for us, may we be put back together. May we be those who are nurtured and nourished at this family table, that we would learn and grow in the ways of our brother, your son, our Savior, Jesus, that we would become like the saints in the light who now enjoy their eternal rest and peace with you. Lord, we thank you for the hands that have ground down the grains, picked the grapes. We thank you for the hearts that are pouring over the elements that we will share together. God, may our thanksgiving be translated into power in your presence. Whether we're eating a saltine cracker and drinking water at the kitchen table at home, watching this service online, or we're peeling back the layers of our communion kits here in the sanctuary today, may these simple elements and we, your simple people, become something greater than the sum of our parts. Equip us so that yet more light and truth from your kingdom would be revealed and manifested through us. Let us mature into the fullness of Christ-likeness as we eat the food of your kingdom. Gracious God, we praise you and ask that you would honor the intention that we bring to this meal as we seek to eat it with Christ's intention in offering it. Amen. Beloved, the invitation goes out to the north and the south, to the east and the west, to Jew, to Greek, to free, to slave, to male, to female, to any and all who would humbly confess and repent of their sin and embrace the saving grace of Jesus the Christ, no matter who we are, where we are on life's journey. All things have been made ready for us, offered free from cost, but paid for at great cost. The food of our King and his kingdom, broken for us, his blood shed for us. Take and eat. lives and life. You are our refuge, our strength. You provide illumination for our journey through the darkness of our own hearts and the darkness of this world. And you give us food for that journey. You strengthen and sustain us. You make us better than we could possibly be on our own or alone. So as we gather one people with one Lord, one God, one faith, one baptism, one hope, one eternal destination, may we be united in the values of your kingdom above and beyond all else, knowing that we have the privilege to pursue the passions of our Savior and share them with a world who needs your healing, your kingdom love. Out of thanksgiving for all of these things and more, we now renew our commitment to the will and way of Jesus the Christ, praying together the prayer he taught his own disciples, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not to temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen and amen. Friends, one of the great joys of being part of Christ's body, universal, as well as part of a local faith family, is that we get to encourage and strengthen and support one another through both the celebrations and the sorrows of this earth. So with that, I would draw your attention to the back of your weekly messenger insert, and there you'll see our updated and ongoing prayer concerns, both our joys and those things that need some intercession. In addition to what you can see printed there, I do want to remind and encourage the folks online that you can download the prayer concerns when you go to the bulletins and newsletter tab on the website. And also, if you have a public prayer, you can type it into the comments field of this video. For those of you who are present in person, you can always fill out a prayer card in the Welcome Center and drop it in the box there or in the offering plate or drop it on Jenny or my desk, what have you. Beyond these items, I do again want to give thanks on this All Saints Sunday for both the gift of new life in all of its forms, as well as the lives who have gone on before us. And if you were not aware, either through the prayer chain or our litany earlier, our dear sister Janice Stettler, after a long battle with declining physical health and dementia, got to go home to God this weekend. And both Bills are doing well. They are grateful that Janice is at peace after these difficulties. Additionally, I've been told of several people in close proximity, emotionally close proximity to some of our church family, folks who are struggling with pretty awful diagnoses around COVID-19, including some folks who, at least as a contributing factor, lost their lives to this current terrible scourge and disease. Another prayer that needs to be lifted up, this is for Larry Noble's 4-year-old grandson, Isaac. He has been diagnosed and is battling with Burkitt's lymphoma. He's currently receiving a course of strong chemotherapy, but of course a 4-year-old child battling lymphoma is significant. And this is the great grandson of Paul and Helen Noble, who were early members of this church. So all of God's children are near and dear to the Lord and should be to us, but certainly there's a special connection in this instance. Friends, I want to give thanks amidst our difficulties for, again, all the saints, all the labors of God's people, whether that's in ministries of maintaining this congregation's work and witness, or if it's your contributions to things like our Saturday dinners or the community outreach event that we will safely be hosting in just a little while here. We give God thanks for one another and the ability to be emissaries of the gospel, the good news of Jesus the Christ, here and now, to all people amidst our diversity and divisions. Are there other pressing joys or concerns for the church family at this time? Karen.
Steve's mom, Wilma Gerber, has the virus, and she's in extended, in the assisted living, so we can't see her other than through her outside window. She is, doing okay on some low oxygen. She has already some pre-existing lung problems, so her breathing, is a little labored, but a little confused, but, doing on the mend. So, but please, she's 91 in February, so, and we had to give her a pep talk. She wanted to stop eating and taking her pills and drinking this week, so we're hoping that our pep talk will do some good, and she'll, she said she's going to try harder, so we said only if you want to, but, so please keep her in your prayers, and Steve.
Bless you, Karen, thank you. Our beloved brother Steve Gerber's mother, who many of you have met over the years, Wilma Gerber, she's in a long-term assisted care facility, is wrestling with COVID along with some other comorbid conditions. Seems to be doing relatively well at the moment, but we need to pray for encouragement, for strength, and for peace throughout this ordeal, not just for Wilma, but for everybody who loves her. And that makes us think, of course, of all the folks who are shut out or shut in at this time, the folks that we really don't get to connect with the way that we would like to out of concern for their safety. We ask that they would really feel our love, our prayers, and also God's presence as they're so isolated. Anything else, folks? Well, as we acknowledged at the communion table, whenever we gather in the name of Jesus, he's present in our midst. So whether it's what's printed in the bulletin, what we've spoken aloud, what you've typed into the comments field, whatever is germinating in your own heart and mind right now, the Lord has already been part of this time of prayer, but let us formalize it now. Holy One, who hears us in our most dire of days, and also deigns to give us dynamic displays of your divinity through our own humanity, we bless you, Lord, that we have the testimony of your people who've gone before us, who have been heroes to us in the faith, that though they may have had feet of clay, gave us something to emulate, to learn and grow after as we mature in our own Christian walk. We thank you for the peaceable consciences we can have through your redeeming grace and the model of our Savior. We bless you, O Lord, that those who are struggling right now do not have to do so alone, that they have the support of your people interceding on their behalf and giving earthly, tangible, real comfort and concern in the here and now. God, we thank you for a new life, for the promise of each infant child, and for all the young people who are navigating this world, but also learning and growing as they go. We thank you for their educators and for the people who feed and clothe, protect and direct them. As we give you our gratitude, we also cry out to you from our places of pain and confusion in a heady mix of emotions and uncertain outcomes in this day and age. We would ask that as children of your kingdom, people of the gospel of Jesus the Christ, we would be peacemakers in all that we say and do. That your kingdom would not only be our inheritance, but that other people would get a taste of it through our living witness. God, as we exercise the privilege and also the responsibility of our individual consciences and the beauty of this particular nation's processes, we'd ask that cool hearts and minds would rule the day, that your order for the universe would be manifested in all that we do as individuals and as a collective nation, that we would indeed be a city on the hill to one another and to the rest of the world. God, help us to continually strive after more and more of who you would have us be. May we not lose our saltiness, but may we also not be salty with each other. Dearest God, in all things, we trust the promise of Scripture, and when we don't know what or how to pray, your Holy Spirit intercedes on our behalf with sighs and groanings too deep for human words. Receive then now our personal, our private, our silent prayers and petitions. Only holy and righteous one, may you do for us what you did for David, that when we poor souls cry out to you from our fear, you will save us, and our faces will be radiant and unashamed before all the nations whom you seek to save. Amen. Season for this congregation. Remember that it is when we bring in the sheaves each year that we take a portion of those seeds and hold them back so that next year when we reinvest those seeds, there would be a bountiful crop into the future, that we are always looking towards becoming more thoroughly, faithfully, effectively who Christ redeems us to be. So out of thanksgiving for the faithful generosity of one another, I call forward now that we would invest our personal time, talents, and indeed our treasures. And you can do that in a variety of ways, even if you're not able to join us in person. You can, of course, swing past the church office throughout the week during regular office hours and drop off your check that way. You can mail it in. You can contact somebody from Finance and Stewardship and get signed up for electronic deductions. You can go to the PayPal accounts under richvilleucc@att.net, and that's where your financial contributions can be made. You can prayerfully take the Time and Talents Pledge card and think about that over the next couple of weeks until Stewardship Sunday, and then turn that in as a commitment for the year ahead. As you all do and have been so faithfully, you can continue to teach. You can continue to minister to the sick and the shut out and shut in our congregation and community. You can keep the grounds beautiful with your volunteer efforts. You all have been remarkable in some less than wonderfully remarkable days. And so we give God thanks for one another and the work we are privileged to do together. With that, let us take up our tithes and our offerings.
Thank you.
draw your attention to the prayer of dedication printed on the back of your messenger. Today it is based upon 1 John 3, 1-3.
In gratitude for the love that you, our Heavenly Father, has given us, we bring these offerings.
Out of thanks for the privilege of being called your children, we present these gifts.
Anoint our contributions, we pray, that they and we would help the world to know us and you more fully and genuinely.
And may we be blessed with wisdom to steward these resources well, that what we give and how we live would continually reveal more and more of who you would have us be.
Help us to see you for who you truly are, and strengthen us to be more like you.
Grant us the ability to purify ourselves and our ties, that we might become pure like you. Amen.
Dear friends, the good news is this. Who we are is not who we have been is not who we are in Christ Jesus. Who we are today is not who he would have us be tomorrow. We are a people of becoming, and we have hope for tomorrow and hope for eternity. Let us walk in that hope, no matter what's going on around us, being united in Christ's saving love. Now may the grace and peace of Jesus the Christ, the fellowship of the Holy Spirit, and the eternal presence of God Most High be with us all, now and forevermore, as we go in peace, loving and serving the Lord and one another. Amen.